to Why in the Morning, and if it's Tuesday, it's Entrepreneurship Tuesday right here on Y254 channel. At Y254 channel is where you can find us across all our social media handles. At Michelle Ashira is where you can find me across all of my socials. In this particular session, we dive into an interview that looks at changing perception of green spaces. All right, you and I know that if there's no green spaces, I don't know where you and I will be at, because the aspect of just relaxation, you know, these spaces, it's also incorporates a good mental and physical health, especially during this time of COVID-19, whereby we can use these spaces to exercise, just take a breather, just enjoying this space where you can run away from the heat, especially when the weather decides another tone, and we just run to the green spaces. And in studio, I am joined by none other than Phyllis Wamaitha. She is an environmental advocate and a lawyer by profession. Happy Tuesday. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm good.
Thank you for having me.
You look fabulous.
Thank you.
So, Phyllis, starting us off, yeah, for someone who's watching this, will be joining us through this conversation, and they're wondering, what are these green spaces you're talking about? And basically, we'll be just going through this conversation under the umbrella of Daima Coalition. Daima Coalition?
Yes,
it is. Yes, Daima Coalition. So, take us through that.
Okay, just to give you a small insight on what the Daima Coalition or the Daima Green Spaces is.
Okay.
Daima Consortium or the Daima Coalition was formed a year ago, that is last year, November. And the reason for the formation of the Daima Coalition is due to the commission of the Nairobi Expressway that happened last year.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened was that when the expressway was commissioned, 1.3 acres of the Uhuru Park were going to be hived off. So this brought about different conservationists as well as environmentalists to come together and see ways in which we can be able to protect the Uhuru Park, because it's been shrinking since 1969.
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot afford to lose 1.3 acres. So we came together and we had an activity called the Daima Uhuru Park, or the Hands of Uhuru Park, last year on November 3rd. And from then we've moved on to not just speak about Uhuru Park, but we've also been focusing on other green spaces and seeing ways in which we can be able to increase green spaces in our cities and country at large.
Okay, I think you're on the lookout for us, the people who love green spaces.
Yeah.
And it's actually important for mental and physical health, as I said earlier on.
Mm-hmm.
But some section of Kenyans will argue that the Nairobi Expressway project, the good intention part of it is that they tend to weigh down on the traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And just, traffic, less traffic, hence the low prices on fuels,
mm-hmm.
especially along Mombasa Road. So what's your take on that?
My take on that with regards to the expressway, one thing that I would like to talk especially to the youth is, when you look at any sort of development, one question that you need to ask yourself is this development sustainable? So when you're talking about the Nairobi Expressway, there has been a lot of issues with regards to its commission. Number one, the environmental impact assessment and audit process was not, the environmental impact assessment process was not due followed as it should be, as it is, written in the MCA as well as our Constitution of Kenya. So the due process was not followed. So that is the first thing. The second thing is that the Nairobi Expressway is supposed to help decongest Nairobi. But the question is, how will it help do that? So I'm just going to give you a small scenario on what the Nairobi Expressway is about, so that
All right.
You can get to understand what our position is. So basically, the Nairobi Expressway is going to provide a medium lane, whereby private cars are going to be using the expressway itself and other public transportation are going to be using the normal routes. So what will happen is that we have 10% of Kenyans who use private means.
Yes.
We have 80% of Kenyans who use public transportation.
Yes,
we have 10% of Kenyans who walk. So the expressway is only going to cater for 10% of Kenyans. So the first question we need to ask ourselves, is this sustainable if it's catering for 10% of Kenyans? Of course it's not, because we need a project that is, first of all, people-oriented,
mm-hmm.
and at the same time caters for most of the citizens. Another thing is that there is the 27 years that we have to pay the 62 billion shillings,
yes,
for the Nairobi Expressway.
Yeah.
And ways in which the government is going to be able to get this money is through the toll system. So we are going to be paying 600 one way if you're using a small car, and if you're using a larger car, then you're going to incur maybe more cost other than 600 shillings. So the idea is that through this toll fee system, then you're going to recover the money during this 27 years. But the situation, or I'm looking at it from a hypothetical situation, mm-hmm. what if we are not able to recover the money? Mm-hmm. What will happen to us as youth? Are we going to have increased taxes for us to be able to do that? What are we going to be able to do so as to ensure that we recover the amount? So kazi ni kwetu as the youth to see ways in which you can be able to question the government, see if this is feasible, is it sustainable? If it's not, let us raise our voice and say no to it.
So you guys are actually requesting, and the fact that access for, you know, clarity, mm-hmm. access of information on how they intend to just implement mm-hmm. this particular project.
Yes. And that has always been an issue, because even the first time when they said they were going to hive off 1.3 acres of the Uhuru Park, mm-hmm. we would ask them, okay, can you kindly share with us the design so that you can be able to see this? The next thing we had was that the Uhuru Park was not going to be hived off, and there were redesigns. Mm-hmm. But then the sharing with the public of the redesigns has been an issue. So we are not able to say for sure, is this expressway going to encroach in green spaces or not. So we're not fully able to say that, because again, we've not been able to get the information as we should.
All right, so let's talk about the reimagining of green spaces by Citizen Project. I saw on your Facebook page that you're actually calling out on Kenyans to come up with the, you know, just reimagining the spaces that you would want to see, the green spaces, that is, if it's parks, mm-hmm. just a place where you can relax and enjoy those particular amazing green spaces. So tell us about this project, and did you get any form of Kenyans who wrote in and told you, you know, this is a particular, you know, bring out their designs that they desire to see in their own country when it comes to green spaces?
So the project on reimagining our parks definitely is currently still ongoing, and we did get a lot of response, especially from the citizens. And just to give you a small insight on what it's about, mm-hmm. basically we want to see ways in which we can be able to reimagine and revitalize our parks. And we used Uhuru Park as one of our example, because, you know, Uhuru Park has been there for 50 plus years. So how can we be able to revitalize the park, especially the Freedom Corner? Because if you remember, mm-hmm. Wangari Maathai was there when she was fighting for the Uhuru Park itself. So the Freedom Corner is very key, especially in matters advocacy and in protecting the park. So how can we be able to revitalize the place? You know, can we come up with drawings on benches? Can we have, you know, different drawings on how it could look beautiful? So those are some of the ideas that we were throwing out to the public, and they could come up, you know, with their own imagination on what their parks look like. And also something that is important also about the reimagining our parks is that we want to ensure that at least in most of our hoods, we're able to have a park, mm-hmm. at least a park in our hood. So we were encouraging the public to look at any sort of green space or open space that they can be able to rehabilitate and turn it into a green space that their hood can be able to enjoy. So it's a very inclusive and engaging activity, and we're currently going on with it. It will definitely go on for a very long time.
And just listening to you and how passionate about you are about this project, Phyllis, it's amazing considering that you guys have been operating for approximately 1 year now. Mm-hmm. All right, so for a person who's watching this conversation and they're wondering who's eligible to be part of the DIMA coalition.
So the DIMA coalition is open to the public. Mm-hmm. It is open to the public. We are a consortium of different environmental organizations, conservation organizations, as well as just environmental enthusiasts like me and you, you know. So if you would like to join us, definitely we do have a space for you. You can reach out to us with your ideas, and definitely we will see how we can be able to carry it into fruition.
Yeah. And has DIMA coalition like stretched to other counties, or are you guys just based within Nairobi?
Currently, most of our activities are in Nairobi. However, we do want to, you know, continue stretching to the different parts of the country.
All right. So I read your biography, mm-hmm. and you emphasize on how we can actually make our green spaces as a tourist attraction. How possible is that?
I think it's very possible because we have a lot of green spaces in our country. Mm-hmm. But one of the issues that we have is, one, there's the disregard of green spaces. You'll find like normal people don't even, not normal people, but the public doesn't know what a green what a green space is. And in most times, when the public doesn't know what a green space is, then they don't get to appreciate and understand the importance of a green space. So green spaces are definitely important, and if we do ensure that we conserve them, then definitely they're going to serve as a tourist attraction. Maybe I can use Karura Forest as an example.
Okay.
You know, the way Wangari Maathai fought for the Karura Forest to what it is right now.
Yes.
So it is through community engagement that, you know, we are able to have tourists, and they can be able to have millions of millions in just a month out of the income from the park itself. So you see, there's a lot of potential in
and I love the fact that you just went on a broader space, because most of the time we talk about green spaces, we look at parks, you know, and then we have our forest. I love Kericho Forest, you know, and it's the largest forest when it comes to zip lining, zip lining in Eastern Africa, which has six lines. So we have a lot that, you know, we can offer to our tourists as a tourist attraction. So let's look at ways we can change the narrative and perception when it comes to the safety of our green spaces. I tend to believe that the majority of Kenyans shy away from parks, especially when these particular parks, they're not, you don't pay for like an entrance fee. There's always an issue of security because it's accessible to everyone. So how can you change the perception and narrative, and how can you come up with ways that we can actually offer security to Kenyans in these spaces?
Okay, with regards to green spaces, I would like to use Karura as an example.
Okay.
Before the Friends of Karura's Community Forest Association was formed, there were a lot of back and forth with regards to private developers wanting to get into Karura and seeing ways in which they can cut the trees and, you know, have their own development. However, once the Community Forest Association was formed, you could see the various changes that came into place. One, there was the collaboration with the Kenya Forest Service and other government agencies, and the collaboration between the two actually helped with regards to security, because they could, one, work on putting up a fence, which can also be key in ensuring the security of the area, and two, there was no push and pull between the KFS and the Community Forest Association. So one, it is very key for you to have good relations with, you know, the relevant government agencies. And another thing that I borrowed from the Karura Forest experience is that if you look at the neighboring communities, in the communities neighboring the Karura Forest, we have one which is the Huruma Village, which is also an informal settlement that is around the area. So what the Community Forest Association did, they involved the communities around the forest. And once you involve the communities around the forest, then they are able to own the project, they're able to own the park or the green space itself. And in the end, they are going to protect it. So you need to involve the people who are around for them to be able to take it up, protect it, and ensure that, you know, there's security, because once the people take it up, then for sure no one is going to come and harm the place. So definitely engagement with the public is very important to ensure the security.
All right. I would like to find a couple of projects that you've engaged in in that span of 1 year that you look back and you're very much impressed and happy to be part of Daima Coalition.
Okay, the first ever Daima Uhuru Park activity last year, November 3rd, was a very huge activity, because, you know, that is where we had our stand and said, you know, we need to have regard for the environment if we're talking about development, that is the expressway. And another milestone that we just had, which is on October 31st, we had the Souls of Our Trees event. And the Souls of Our Trees event basically was to protect the 100-year iconic fig tree that is in Westlands, you know, from being fell as a result of the expressway. So that was a very huge milestone, because a week after our walk, we had a presidential decree by the NMS general body saying that the tree has been unmarked for felling, and there'll be benches and around the tree for wananchi to sit down. And that was more than a win, because we can see that environment has been has not been compromised as a result of development.
Yeah,
so that was one of the biggest wins, I will say. That was and also just to see the power of the youth, because if you look at the project itself, it was 100% spearheaded by the youth, and seeing the results as well, I think it gives a lot of power to the youth that we actually have this power and this voice.
Yes, and I'm very
change.
Much curious on ways you mobilize and actually engage the youth to be part of Daima Coalition, because it's not something easy to, especially for the youth of nowadays. So just how do you mobilize and engage the youth to just persuade them to be part of this particular organization?
The first thing, of course, we do reach out to the environmental enthusiasts, nature lovers. Of course, those are some of the a small niche that we need to fully empower, because these are going to be our voices in terms of environmentalism. Mm-hmm. However, we also reach out to the general public, because when you talk about environmental matters, they're not just for a particular group. Environmental protection or environmental conservation is something to be enjoyed by everyone.
Absolutely.
So the moment you let the public and the youth, just the general youth, know that if you do not stand up, then it's going to affect you in this way and this way, then people come to understand, mm-hmm. okay, this is not just an environmentalist, you know, campaign, but it's a campaign for all of us. So yeah, just letting them know how important it is, and you know how it's going to affect them in one way or another, definitely does, you know, mm-hmm. rile up a couple
right.
of youth.
So like, apart from just pushing for accountability, mm-hmm. To access information also from the government when it comes to protecting our green spaces, what are some of the steps that movement that you're partaking onto to ensure that our green spaces are actually being protected as a organization?
Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we're doing, definitely advocacy and
yes.
raising our voices. I think that is, you know, very
much important, actually. Yeah,
that is, and also just letting the public know the mm-hmm. importance of green spaces. What are green spaces? What do they constitute? What kind of green spaces do we have? Mm-hmm. And one thing Daima is currently working on is documenting all of these green spaces, because we have green spaces in Kenya that are not documented as well.
Mm-hmm.
So how can you be able to document them? And you can have a database whereby if you want to look at green spaces in Kenya, then you can be able to log on to there and you can see all the different green spaces in Kenya. So that is something that is very important, and that's a niche that hadn't been done yet, so that's something that we're also working on. And we also want to work closely with the government to see ways in which we can be able to protect our trees, especially in matters development, because as you've seen with the expressway, especially mm-hmm. like from James Kishuru, there are over 5,000 trees that have been felled just along that route. So how can we be able to account for this trees? Because you can't tell us you're going to cut trees in Wayakiwe mm-hmm. and plant them at the Nairobi National
it's
Park.
It's impossible.
No, doesn't work.
Yes.
So we need to have a method, or we need to come up with a certain document that we can be able to go off of to say that if you've cut trees here, then this and this mm-hmm. are the ways in which you can be able to ensure that we reinstate the area.
Come on an equal ground.
Karibu. Yeah.
Yes.
Kabisa.
So what are the roles of the citizens when it comes to safeguarding mm-hmm. and enhancing our green spaces?
Our role and our key role is raising our voice, mm-hmm. because we as the public have a lot of power and we have a lot of strength.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes I feel like we don't know what to do, especially in such kind of, you know, a situation of such magnitude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to talk about the expressway, but you're like, you know, if I rant over social media, what will I do? You know, no one will be able to hear me. You know, there's always that feeling that there's not much that you can do. But I would like to let you guys know that there's mm-hmm. a lot that you can do just by raising your voice, just by coming up with ideas and reaching out to us as the Daima Green Spaces. And not just us, we have other organizations
mm-hmm.
that are doing amazing things to protect the green spaces.
Mm-hmm.
So us as the public, we have the responsibility to raise our voices.
Mm-hmm.
We have the responsibility to come up with ideas to ensure that we increase the number of green spaces that we have. And we also have a responsibility to ensure to keep the government accountable, especially in matters sustainable development, to ensure that in the event that, you know, there's disregard for the environment,
mm-hmm.
then the public is able to stand up and say, this should not be done, and we need our trees to survive.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how are you guys raising funds when it comes to running the organization?
We fundraise.
Mm-hmm.
We normally do fundraise. Let's say if we do have an activity, we reach out to different, you know, donors who would like to, you know, help in one way or another. And we can say so far we've been able to, you know, conduct our activities
mm-hmm.
The way we've been hoping. And we definitely want to reach out to more people who would like to, you know, help us in one way or another, so that we can be able to speak out for generations to come. Because that's what we're doing. When we're doing, when we're increasing our parks, basically we're taking care of the generations to come.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very true, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And for someone who's watching this conversation on an aspect or from an angle of being an investor or
mm-hmm.
someone who would like to just, you know, be part or help in terms of financially or any other way
mm-hmm.
around it, because it's not always about the money,
yes,
right?
Not always about the money.
So how can they help out?
You can reach out to us at Daima Green Spaces.
Okay.
Just reach out to us at Daima Green Spaces.
We'll from there, we'll take it.
Yeah.
You guys will take it up from
uh-huh.
there. So tell us more about the anniversary of Hands Off Uhuru Park that will be taking place on 21st of mm-hmm. November.
Yeah. So we're really
take
excited.
Us that and the activities that will actually be going down mm-hmm. on that particular day.
Yeah, so on 21st November, we're going to have our anniversary, Hands Off Uhuru Park. That is the one that I said on November 3rd mm-hmm. last year.
Okay.
So we're going to have our anniversary on 21st November, and we're going to have it at the Freedom Corner,
okay.
Uhuru Park. And basically some of the activities that we're looking to, you know, talk about, one, we're going to talk about the history of the Uhuru Park. I came to realize there are not so many people who even understand the history of the park, how it shrunk, when it started in 1969. So those are some of the things that we'll be going through. We're also going to look at the life and works of Wangari Maathai, because you can't talk about Uhuru Park without Wangari Maathai.
What's your favorite quote by Wangari Maathai, by the way?
My favorite quote has to be, if you do not raise your voice, uh-huh. then your environmentalism means nothing.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that is my key one. So okay. that every time I don't raise my voice, then I know I've done nothing. Okay. So yeah.
So what are a couple of activities that will be going down the platform, just taking us through the history of how Uhuru Park came mm-hmm. by?
Yeah, some of the activities, definitely we'll have a fun day activity, a mm-hmm. family fun day activity. We're going to have music. And yeah, on top of that, we are going to do some activities on reimagining the park. I had already mentioned that.
Yes,
so
yes.
that will also be an interesting day to see how we can be able to put it into action, mm-hmm. see how we can be able to revitalize mm-hmm. the area, especially the Freedom Corner.
All right. Mm. That's amazing. So everyone is invited?
Yeah, everyone is invited. It's a free park. There's no entry fee. It's a beautiful park. You're all invited mm-hmm. to the Freedom Corner on 21st November.
Okay. Yeah. So what is the future of green spaces looking like, especially in Kenya?
In Kenya, I think the future is looking bright.
Mm-hmm.
The future is looking bright because the topic of green spaces is currently being very prevalent. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to see that young people are actually taking it up and seeing the need of green spaces, especially now with the current COVID mm-hmm. restrictions. You know, people didn't have a lot of access to parks. And I think this year especially has been a turning point because people have come to see the necessity of having green spaces and necessity of having parks. And also the fact that the government is also welcoming such ideas on protecting green spaces, ideas mm-hmm. on seeing how we can increase the same is also very amazing. So seeing ways in which we can be able to bring the two together and increase the green spaces, definitely I see our future being more than bright if mm-hmm. we continue with the same momentum that we have. Yeah.
And what about Daimo Coalition?
Our future is more than bright. and that's because we are not going to stop until we increase our green spaces, until uh-huh. our green spaces are protected, until oh, they are yeah. revitalized.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely we will be there for a very long time.
Yeah. All right. So how can guys reach out to you if they want to have, just remind us your social media handles, you mentioned them, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how can guys reach out to those particular social media handles? Kindly remind us and so that people back at home can mm-hmm. easily follow okay. up.
So you can reach out to us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Daima Green Spaces.
Mm-hmm.
So come up with your ideas, DM us, and we'll reach out to you, and we'll actualize them.
All right. So guys back at home, that was Phyllis. She is an environmentalist and a lawyer by profession, working with the organization Daima Coalition. So guys, if you want to reach out to Daima Coalition, head on to us, their social media handles, that is at Daima Coalition, and you can get further information from their website, social media handles,
Daima Green Spaces.
Daima Green Spaces on social media.
Mm-hmm.
Great. So as simple as that, you get more information on how you can be part of this amazing project, and you're invited for the event on 21st
November.
November.
Mm-hmm.
This actually is actually this month.
It's this Saturday.
This Saturday.
Yeah.
Pictures mm-hmm. are there, you know. These pictures are part of...
That's what the Freedom Corner is.
Freedom Corner
yeah,
is that.
Uhuru
okay.
Park.
So,
this revitalization.
Preparation?
No, this is, you know, when you talked about revitalization of uh-huh. the park, we want to see ways in which you can enhance it.
Ah.
So this can be through benches,
uh-huh.
through different, you know, seating arrangements, uh-huh. seeing ways in which you can just expand our functions there. So basically...
Making the spaces way beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
There you have it.
With more activities.
Yeah. So there it is. For me, Saturday, November 21st. This is at
mm.
So guys, head on to Uhuru Park at an event of... the name of the event is Hands Off Uhuru Park. So be part of that particular event, and it's free of charge. There you have it. So make sure you stay tuned. We have more on Y in the Morning at Y254 channel. So you can find us across all our social media handles at Michelle Ashira. Make sure you don't touch that dial. We'll be right back with more on Entrepreneurship Tuesday.